Go.
Hey, there we go. It seems like we're live. So hello, everybody. I'm Tripp. You know me. You should know me because this is on my book pages. I'm the guy that's been reading you books. And this is my friend Hollis Jo McCollum. She is also a author. She's a fantasy author. I read her first book, Save a World, which I would recommend. She had a couple more recently, though, that I haven't gotten around to yet because I've been shit for reading this year. But she also voices GySgt Chanceworth in my book, Smokepit Fairytales. So that's why we're here tonight. It's for you guys' content. So yeah. Now we get to do the thing where we pretend like we haven't been talking for half an hour.
Yeah, we are. Yes. this is the first we've spoken today. How are you?
I'm very well. How are you?
Fun.
So one of the things that I did want to talk about, though, with the voice acting and stuff was, like, you're a sweet, fun person, and the character you played is just a giant bitch. Yeah. And it's like, there's a fun juxtaposition in here if you, like, know what's going on, you know?
It is. I actually was hoping, like, well, and you know, when I emailed you, I was like, yeah, I want the bitch. Can you, I'd do that one. And I thought it was Chanceworth, of course, but I wasn't 100% because it has been a couple of years since I read your books. Right. But, And I haven't finished the series yet. Like you, I'll get around to it. I've been very bad about reading myself. But yeah, I love playing the bitchy characters. Because yeah, I'm nice in person. Yeah. I'm cool. But I'm also, you know, I like playing D&D. And I like playing different personalities. And frankly, I'm not a bitch in real life. So sometimes it's fun to be one.
I need to role play this because I don't get to do it in real life.
Yeah, I need to. I mean, I could be, but people don't want to work with me if I'm a bitch in real life. So,
I mean, how that works?
Yeah.
Speaking of that, though, I have been playing a friggin' my buddy got me into Dungeons and Dragons. Like, I'm on my first campaign still.
Yay!
But because, you know, I don't know how to play the game, he's like, all right, I'm just going to set everything up for you. So here you go. You are a dwarf warlock, you got transported here from your world. And we've been going what I think is called murder goblin-ing.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we keep just getting ambushed by dudes in the woods, and my dungeon master is getting really tired of me just screaming, Charlie's fucking everywhere!
Well, you know, I think that and that's part of the fun, is like you can just yell and scream and you can come up with weird shit. Like one of my friends has a paladin, you know, which paladins, if people don't know, they're good knights, you know, like knights like armor and shit. And they are really powerful, but they tend to be like over noble and like, this is right and that is wrong. And I don't do wrong things and blah, blah, blah. But the best part is really, you know, he's a man of few words and he's really overpowered, but he's an idiot who cannot read.
Okay.
So, and we didn't actually figure it out until like in like a month or two into the campaign that he couldn't read, that Ragnar, his character's name was Ragnar, couldn't even fucking read. And we were just like, one of our characters, because all our other characters could read in several other languages. And there was a point where Ragnar had to go off on himself on his own. And there was a sign that had valuable information on it. And you know, my brother, who was the DM, was like, so what is it? You know, so you want to look at this sign says this. And true to his character, my friend was like, Ragnar ignores and walks inside. And he's like, whoa, are you sure? And he's like, Ragnar cares not for word. And then he just went in and he got ambushed, thankfully survived. But it was like, and we were like, what the fuck? Why didn't you read? And he's like, Ragnar can't read. He doesn't do words. Having you notice, I never read fucking anything. And we were like, he didn't. You kind of screwed yourself, but it was all right. He couldn't read, accidentally walked into like a viper pit, and it was fine. It was fine.
It'd be like that sometimes. Yeah. And then like all of us in the game are all new. It's all our first time. So we've been just torturing the fucking dragon master.
Dungeon master, officially. Yeah.
It's one of the words, right? But it's like, all right, so what are you guys going to do today? You got this letter. You talk to this vampire guy. You're supposed to go get this stone. Oh, we're going to go to the beach.
Yeah.
The beach is that way, but the rock's that way. Yeah, well, we're going to go to the beach.
Mm-hmm. We want to go then, put some shit over there.
And if anything ambushes us, bad things are going to happen. So we get ambushed, and then after we kill everybody, like, we have an orgy. because we wanted to go to the beach, and if we can't go to the beach, we're gonna fuck.
That is what you do. That is, I mean, that's how we play D&D, and that's just it. And that's, I mean, and then you get wildly drunk. And I know that one of my brothers, I mean, and again, we've been playing D&D since like middle school. We're total dorks, but we're cool dorks. Like, I think my brother's like king of the nerds because he's like 6'2", personal trainer, second degree black belt in Shaolin Kung Fu, fucking huge, impressive guy. And he is such a huge nerd, but whenever he walks into the nerd store, the other nerds are like, oh my God, because he's so knowledgeable about all that shit. Like, yeah, all of it.
So. Well, no, it was funny though, because like, you know, when, you know, I was growing up, we were growing up because we were talking about that, about the same ish age, but like, you know, nerds were like kind of like the dweebs. Mm-hmm. And then like nowadays it's like, no, the fucking football dude and the weightlifter guy fucking will tell you absolutely fucking everything about why Batman or Spider-Man would not do that.
Right. Because now it's okay. And we all know that the jocks secretly liked the comic books anyway. Yeah. But now it's cool. I don't know. At least now it's out in the open, whatever. I just got back from Dragon Con last weekend. So
how was that?
It was fun. I've had some health issues, so I need to be taking it easy because, well, and you know, I think I've mentioned to you before that, like, I am like a medical anomaly that my doctors have published studies on. It's super fucking fun. Yeah, I had some
shit. There's one way to get your name in a book.
Yeah, I am. Well, my name isn't, I am like patient E or something, but yeah, it's good. But yeah, I had some shit flare up, so But I went, I made some marketing materials. I went there with my friend Alara Dunn, who is also, she just published July 25th, her first book. It's a YA fantasy, which is really cool. And yeah. And so we went and we just like hung out. And then my best friend and I went and basically wandered around, made idiots of ourselves, high-fived a bunch of cosplayers and dressed up like our characters. And she dressed up, we were Yoselin and Ethne on Sunday, my best friend and I.
Oh, I think I saw one of the pictures.
Yeah. So that was fun. So but I took it easy this year. I took it very, very easy. Yeah. I had my horns. I love it. I have so many devil horns in my cosplay closet. I need to use more of them.
Oh. Yeah.
Right. I need more devil costumes or something. I use a lot of them in my pole stuff because Halloween is coming up and we always do Halloween creepy pole routines, which I fucking love. And I do a lot of my demon horns and like shitty blood makeup and everything for that. So I love that.
Yeah. But like I never know how to respond to those kind of like posts where it's like, yeah, do more of that. And then it's like, wait a minute. No, she's naked. Don't say that. You look good. No, don't say that either. I want to see more of
I want to see more of you being a demon and very sexual, but as a friend. Is that okay?
I like it when you're all horned up, but like, you know, I don't want to say that on the internet because I don't want you to think I'm a weirdo. And then my wife.
I know you're not a weirdo, but I understand how other people might. Yeah, but yeah. Like, and trust me, you'd like the people I see on my poll account. That comment wouldn't even phase.
Well, fucking, so me and what is it? Tam Jackson, Damian Larkin, and Michelle Packard are in this like writing fucking group chat. Mm-hmm. And Michelle was sending us these fucking screenshots of the Indian dudes fucking hitting on her. You know, like, yeah. You know, hey, baby, blah, 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 whatever. And it kind of became a running joke where like sometimes like late at night we'll just text her that, but like not the pictures, like type it out.
Hi, you marry me? You like, yeah.
You're so beautiful woman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been getting those, and I love it because as a woman in her 40s to have some 18-year-old Indian kid, like, yeah. You know, like, you so pretty, you want boyfriend, you want husband? I'm like, me've had two, has had on second.
I'm just gonna type goddamn you're hot and move on. Like, is that too, delete comment fuck.
Yeah, well, a lot of them were looking for green cards, which is why, but they see you're an American woman who might be single, because, you know, I'm married, I'm happy about it, but I don't post. My husband's a very private person, number one, but number two, like, my author account isn't about him, it's about my books. So
yeah
they, like, don't,
I don't see, even think I'm married to my wife on Facebook.
Yeah No, it's like, yeah.
I think we're friends on Facebook.
I don't know. I'm never on Facebook, so I honestly couldn't tell you who I'm friends with on there anymore or not.
Yeah.
Probably. I'm sure I followed you back in the early days, back when I still checked Facebook, which I don't. I've missed many invitations to birthday parties and baby showers, I'm sure.
Yeah. No, like most of my Facebook page, or the one for the books, is just like the auto push from fucking Instagram, which this is being broadcast to that Facebook right now. So hi guys, there's a reason I haven't been being responsive. So they don't check fucking Facebook.
If anyone follows me too, same reason. I do not check Facebook. I have a life. We all have lives, but like, I only have space in my head for like one social media, and that is Instagram, and I'm done. Mm-hmm. Maybe YouTube. Okay, Instagram, YouTube.
Does YouTube count as social media though?
Hmm?
Does YouTube count as a social media?
Officially, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, officially. That is what I have learned in the working force is that it does. But
okay.
I just put whatever reels I make, I just post them. But basically, everything is pretty much the same. The only thing that's different about my YouTube channel is my podcast is on there.
And that one's a little bit different because, you know, that's a, you know, direct engagement with the camera. Hello, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah. Wow. If you watch the video, because there's like video and the live stream and the just the, you know, graphic of my podcast that you can listen to.
Is Spotify a social media too, or is that a broadcasting platform?
I want to say broadcasting platform. I'd have to look that one up.
Yeah.
I'd say broadcasting would be my guess.
And I'll upload the audio to this to Spotify later. So if you're listening to this on Spotify later, that's what's up.
Speaking of Spotify, you've been killing it on Spotify lately. Yeah.
Yeah. And those bastards cut out all my, they completely fucking like delete. They don't delete the episodes. Like the ones that are like more, the chapters that are more raunchy, they're just like, all right, so this is going to be up, but you can't look for it. And if you go to the actual Spotify app and look on your thing, it's not there. It's got zero views. So, Don't be making the sex noises. I'm like, I've listened to raunchy books on here before, man. I've seen the pod. Like, how many followers do I need before I can post that?
Yeah, seriously. Like, honestly, I wonder about. I mean, and yeah, it's like your brand of raunchy is a little different. But honestly, what is so different between some of the shit that goes on in, you know, historical romance novels and the shit that you write? It's not any more vulgar or, well, maybe vulgar, but like, it's not any more graphic. They're equally graphic, if not, honestly, the romance novels are more graphic and a lot.
You know, I think mine might be more graphic. If the acts themselves aren't, the presentation is.
Well, because, the vomit, like, certainly didn't help.
Yeah. Well, I mean, well, the thing is, though, is like,
I got a strong stomach, but I do not like vomit because I have to throw up a lot. Like, because
the characters didn't either.
Yeah. Well, nobody liked it. No, but I didn't read that fully. I kind of skimmed that one a little bit. I must admit, I was like, I don't want to read that.
Well, yeah. No, but what I was going to say, though, is like most audiobooks are this person reading this in this voice for the entire duration of the book. And then if you get a what is considered good audiobook, I will do this character with this voice and this character with this voice. But I got different voice actors. So, like, The graphic scenes, like, close your eyes and it's like, you know, oh hey, I'm watching a movie, you know. Which I gotta say, God bless Diane Spencer for that, because I sent her the script and I was like, I'm never gonna hear from this woman again. And then say, oh, here it is. I'm like, oh shit.
He's amazing. And you know what? That's kind of on brand for her, you know. Stand-up, she gets fucking raunchy, and that's one of the reasons I love her, and I have followed her for years. She's been a favorite comedian of mine, I think, since 2016 or something. I've been watching her for a while.
Oh yeah, no, I absolutely love her. She is my favorite comedian. But it was also like, now I have to edit this shit. I don't want to feel dirty about it. Oh, and I have to do the guy part. Oh, this is my wife's in there. Oh, god damn it.
Honey, look away. Can you run errands like now? How does now sound to go to the store? Do you want to do that? Did you want to go meet your friends for a while? I just, please leave for both our sakes.
Yeah. I found her, 24, 15, 15 ish.
Yeah. I think I found her in 2016. I just found her because I love stand up.
Yeah.
And so I was just like looking for a new stand up comedian to
Yeah.
listen to, and she popped up and I was like, cool. And then I was hooked. I like looked at all her specials and everything. I was like into it.
Yeah, that one she did in that comedy basement in Los Angeles where she's talking about the Saw movies and they weren't Vienna sausage.
Yeah, the sausage. It's like, I
Oh,
really must chew
this
my.
is gross. Subscribe.
Well, and I was so like, she did beautifully in that special, but I was actually upset with the audience's reaction because the American, like her British audiences are great, but the American audience was like a little clutching the pearls. I was like, dude,
Well, I mean, good for her on that. But also, I got a couple other buddies that are comedians. Like the guy that plays Eclair, is a stand-up comedian around here. Well, not around here. He moved to Cincinnati recently. But he'll send me shit all the time. And I'll be like, yeah, this is cool. But your audience sucks. And no, the audience was kicking ass. I'm like, you
really?
sure? He's like, yeah, the microphone just didn't pick it up. I'm like, this makes a lot more fucking videos make me a lot happier, you know?
That makes me happier if the microphone is it. Because and actually, I'm one of those people, I'm not a loud laugher. Now
Yeah.
that you say that, I'm enjoying myself and smiling, I'm laughing, but I'm not like, wah.
But like I feel like I'm holding in a sneeze and it really fucking hurts.
Yeah. Because I don't want to interrupt the show at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah, I want to be rude to my donkey. That
Yeah, you don't want to be that person who's just.
was the fucking worst. The opposite side of that, where there's one guy. Ah!
Oh my God. Yeah. Well, we all know at least one of those people in real life.
Yeah. Okay, so that's not me at comedy shows, but like at movie theaters, I talk a lot. Like I talk so much that the black people tell me to shut up. Like
My husband would ask you to leave. He would be like, can you get out of the theater? I cannot with the
no, because I'm funny about it. So like he might be thinking it, and then person's gonna do something stupid, and then I'm gonna say something quippy, and he'd be like, okay, that was good.
Yeah, actually, well, and see, for me, when somebody's talking in the movie, they better be fucking clever, 'cause if they're not, then I am upset if you're ruining it. But if you're enhancing the
Well, the way I
film,
look at it is everyone behind me is watching an episode of Mystery Science Theater 3000. And for the kids at home, that's the one where they would go watch a movie and you just see their silhouettes in the front and they'd make snarky comments. Like I think it was
Oh,
Swamp Thing they
Mikhail.
were watching, and the monster shows up and goes, "Holy shit, it's Ted Nugent."
Man. I loved that show when I was that was a great 90s. Like Joel McHale was. I know they had some other guys on there too, but Joel was the one that I remember the most.
Yeah,
That was one of his early shows.
and then they brought it back with Patton Oswalt, but I didn't ever see that one because that was after I stopped having cable and, you know.
Yeah, Patton Oswalt was one of the bad guys that was sending the cheesy movies.
Ah, okay.
I saw like a couple episodes of it. And it was good. It was good, but it just wasn't, it can't ever be recreated. It
No.
was what it was.
I mean, I think that's a problem with a lot of legacy franchises where it's like, all right, we're gonna make this for the people that like this in the 80s and 90s. It's like, yeah, but we're 40 now, and I just want to watch that original thing again.
Yeah,
Not this
I'm like,
duplicate
I'm good.
stuff.
I really just want the stuff that I know I loved in the same vein.
Like make some new action figures. I'll go buy those. I don't need to see the movie. But if and then I think the other problem that adds into that is that they also try to either also make it for the new generation who doesn't get it because they weren't alive, so they couldn't care about it fucking however far long ago. And they don't want to go invest themselves in the backstory. Do I have something in my mustache or is that oh yeah, sorry.
No, I think you're good. From
No,
here,
I'm going white.
yeah, the lighting gets a little wonky, but no, I agree with you. And honestly, the whole like generational gap with humor too, I have noticed, and I'm sure you have too, that like Gen Z or Xennials or whatever they're called, are they don't find like sarcastic humor funny. They don't find like bashing each other funny. And I'm like, that is what we fucking lived on in
Yeah.
the 80s and 90s. Are you kidding me? That is what we lived on. That was it. Sarcasm is a love language, and you need to get into it. It's, but
You know,
they don't even think it, they don't understand why it's hilarious. And I'm like,
You know, I think that swings in and out, though, of is the zeitgeist the right term for that?
Maybe.
Let's see. I think that's...
We're writers. Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. I'm using this word correctly. I think that'll swing in and out of the zeitgeist because, like, because, like, right now, also, like, dick and fart jokes, like, aren't funny. But it's like, dude, if you go back and read, I don't know, any Greek or Latin play, they're all gay sex jokes. And if you go read fucking most Roman plays, they're all like, oh, hey, I banged this hooker. Look at this guy's giant or small wiener jokes. And if you read Shakespeare.
Oh, it's all sex jokes.
It's all sex jokes.
Yeah. It's every single thing, no matter if it's a serious play or not.
And then if you get like one of the books where it's like, okay, this play is this long, but the rest of this is explaining it. It's like, okay, this word is a triple entendre because her vagina is the size of the ocean. His penis is the size of a thimble. The king's name translates to dick butt in ancient fucking Gaelic, you know? So it's like, this is 16 jokes right here. And they're all sex jokes.
Yep. And they're all funny.
Yeah.
Every single one of them. Mm-hmm.
Even if I read it at the sidebar, it's like, oh.
Yeah. And even if I'm like, personally, I don't really like poop jokes just because they're just gross, but like sex jokes are hilarious. Yeah. Poop jokes, I understand the humor. I do get it. But I don't laugh at them. I'm just like, it doesn't hit me like that. Maybe I need to be more into toilet humor, but I'm not. But I understand it. I get the appeal. I do. My husband loves poop jokes.
I think it's situational though. So like one of the things that I did in my fourth book. And for those of you listening at home, this book's been out for a while. If you're waiting for the audiobook, sorry. But anyway, they're on a spaceship. And a dude's got there's this bug going around where everyone's got, you know, explosive diarrhea and violent vomiting, and it's mostly under control, but then they hit something and the gravity goes out.
Oh shit. Yeah.
It's just a chapter of that.
Biohazard. Just a biohazard chapter, essentially.
I think that I did the thing where what I try to do in my books is, depending on how you look at it, it's either hilarious or horrifying, and it all depends on how you read it.
Yeah. Well, stop me if I've told you this real life biohazard diarrhea story before. And so I used to work, when I was in college, I worked retail at Kohl's department store. And there was a situation where we had to shut down the entire department store because there was a trail of liquid shit.
Oh man.
From the children's department all the way around the walkways to the restrooms, which were in the back of the store and into one of the stalls. Unfortunately, what happened was there was an older lady who clearly had an issue, a very unexpected digestive issue.
Yeah.
And she just started shitting when she was looking for some stuff for her grandkids. And it was like coming out her pant leg because she had pants on. And then she just started hustling to the bathroom, which was all the way in the back of the store. So she had to like go around a couple departments and leaving a little diarrhea trail, like really bad liquid diarrhea trail into the bathroom, into one of the stalls. And because of the biohazard, we just had to shut the entire store down in the middle of the day. And we don't know what happened to this woman, by the way. She was like...
So she ninja'd out afterwards.
She fucking... Well, and here's the thing. Like, we all felt bad for her as the employees. So, like, we actually went to one of the clearance racks and got some pants with elastic waist that we got a couple different sizes that looked like they would fit her. And the manager went into the bathroom and just said, she was in the stall and they said, you know, ma'am, you know, don't worry about anything. We want you to know, like, we have a plastic bag here for your dirty pants and underwear. And on the countertop here are a pair of clean pants for you. Please. They're yours to keep. They're for free. Just go ahead and take them and you can put your other ones in this bag and, you know, we don't have to worry about anything. you know, and like, no problem, no worries. And if you would like us to let you out the back of the store, we'll be happy to do that too. I'll be waiting outside. She was waiting outside the bathroom. The manager went and waited outside of the door. She wasn't going to wait in there and embarrass her. Yeah. And she never fucking saw this lady leave. There was no exit. We don't know, but she went back in and checked, and the lady was just gone.
Was there a window, or was this the phantom pooper?
It was just phantom. She just ghosted in the truest sense, like dissipated. Her embarrassment caused her to evaporate. And Kohl's has security cameras everywhere. We don't know what happened to this woman. It's like the unexplained files. I don't know. we had to shut down the whole store. And it was like, it wasn't like terrible, but it was in December. Mm-hmm. So it was like a really crowded, you know, it was shopping season. So it was really crowded. Well, before Amazon was around, but this was the early 2000s. So everybody was still shopping outside. Sorry.
Well, that like Amazon was like a bookstore at the time, right? Because mm-hmm. they didn't start selling other shit until what, 2010s?
Kohl's still just clothes, you know, like we had the men's, the women's, the kids, the shoes, and then we had housewares in the back. It's like kind of like a TJ Maxx.
I'm at Amazon wasn't.
Oh, Amazon. They were selling other things in the early 2000s, but they had just started. Sorry, I missed that part. Yeah, but when they first started, they were just books, because I remember they would like in the 90s commercials measure the Taj Mahal and be like, nope, still not big enough to hold all the books that Amazon sells.
Back to the old commercials.
Yeah. We've come full circle. Congratulations to us.
I had something similar happen like that kind of sort of once, and it freaked everybody the fuck out because, you know, I was at work. This is back when I was in the Marines. You know, we're at the fucking shop, and this old dude comes in, and we're like, first, we're kind of like, how this guy get on base, but whatever. And this guy's like, oh, hey, this used to be my old barracks. Do you mind if I, you know, go whatever? Because our buildings were old barracks. They turned into, you know, like offices or, you know, fucking whatever. And my corporal fucking, you know, take this guy in the back. So, yeah, this is my rack where this is my rack was before, you know, I went to Korea. I'm like, cool. So what are you doing here, man? And the dude fucking evaporated. And we're like, let's not tell anybody about that.
Nope. Didn't exist.
Yeah. I mean, like, you didn't, like, you just poof out of the air, but it was like, you look over here and it's like, oh, where the fuck did he go?
It's like a Mandela.
Yeah.
I swear to God, the whole Mandela effect is like, a lot of it is just like, maybe we just like warped into another dimension and we didn't realize it. Like, we're on, like, I don't even know. I hear some of this other shit. Did you know, you remember Publishers Clearinghouse with Ed McMahon knocking on people's doors with the giant checks, right?
Yeah.
And it was definitely Ed McMahon, right?
I don't remember that it was Ed McMahon, but I remember the commercial.
Okay. Well, apparently, and like, I remember it as Ed McMahon. A lot of other people my age remember it as Ed McMahon. But apparently, according to the internet, it was never Ed McMahon. And I'm like, bullshit. Bullshit. It's just like, there are so many other things. I'm like, this is another dimension that we have stumbled into. Sci-fi is real. I don't care.
Well, I mean, I think a lot of that, though, is just kind of like misremembering, because like the other big one is the Shazam movie with Sinbad where he's a genie. It's like, mm-hmm. No, it was Kazam and it was Shaq, but the rest of that's the same.
There were two movies. There was a Sinbad genie movie and then there was the Shaq movie.
I only remember one of them.
I remember both of them. They both existed, I believe.
Yeah.
Because I liked Sinbad. Sinbad was one of the first comedians that I, you know, of course he was really popular in the 90s, but he's one of the first comedians that I started paying attention to as a kid.
Well, he also did like kid movies and stuff. So, I mean.
Yeah. That helped.
I mean, and even if they weren't kid movies, they were like, it was the 90s that, like, I don't know. When I was 10, my favorite movie was fucking Terminator 2. I don't think I should have been watching that. Or a kid nowadays would not be watching Terminator 2 at 10 years old.
Oh, fuck no.
With the training wheels.
No. I look at some of the shit that I watch and I fucking loved and I still love. And I'm like, oh shit, I watched that when I was 4.
Yeah.
I guess I turned out all right. Perhaps desensitized to a degree, but oh fucking well, I made it through. Yeah. I don't know.
I loved Conan the Barbarian when I was a kid.
I watched Conan. I read Sonya. Do you remember? Okay, and this is very, very random, but the animated, and it's an animated film, but it's a very serious and actually rather gory film, Watership Down.
I remember it vaguely, but I do know what you're talking about.
Okay. The first 5 minutes, and it's a, you know, for those of you who don't know, Watership Down was like a political allegory, but told with rabbits and everything, but it's actually quite, you know, violent, and there's a lot of like war and things like that that happened, but it was really good. I loved it. And the first 5 minutes are like an animation of this like cool tribal animation of how rabbits came to be and like the animals fucking killing each other and like cartoon blood spurting everywhere. And that's the first 5 minutes of the film. And then it goes into like happy bunnies with meadows. And then the like construction machines are coming in and destroying the rabbit homes. And they're like getting crushed to death under wheels. And
I'm got it.
Yeah. And then they had to go find it. And they're getting caught on barbed wire fences and drowning in rivers and like all this shit. And I'm like, there's some good parts too, you know, some happy parts too, but like, and they run into evil bunny society that's like evil dictator that is awful, a lot of it. And I'm like, that, I watched that when I was 4 years old and I would not stop watching it. I fucking loved that movie. That and my parents were like, we can't take it away from her now because
it was just done.
It's damage is done. And also if we start telling her that she can't watch it, then there are more questions as to the why. So we're just going to damage control as much as we can, but we can't tell her not to watch it. We're just going to make sure she doesn't introduce it to any of her friends. That's what we're going to do.
That reminds me though of, did you ever see a movie called One Crazy Summer?
Oh, I heard about that. Oh yeah. Wait, is that with,
John Cusack and Demi Moore and Bobcat Goldthwait, but John Cusack, cartoon animator, and it's the movie about like this, the summer after senior year, we got to go do crazy thing. But he's drawn this cartoon at the beginning of it, because it's like an 80s rom-com comedy fucking thing.
I think I saw it like 20 or 30 years ago. I love John Cusack.
But he has this rhino character, and it's going around, and he's looking for love, and like loves this like, you know, cherub angel thing, but it's blind, going around with a cane, he can't find it. And he finds a bunch of cute and fuzzy bunnies, and the rhino's like, hey, cute and fuzzy bunnies, I'm looking for love. Can you show me where love is? And then, like, the cute and fuzzy bunnies, like, light cigarettes and start drinking, and they're like, ah, they, like, do a thing, and like, roses are red, violets are blue, love would have nothing to do with you. So, like, the rhino starts crying for a minute before he puts down his suitcase and then pulls out an Israeli submachine gun and just starts fucking, like, squacking all the bunnies, and then, like, then it comes into junkies and realizes, like, he's like ripping up the paper, like, okay, yeah, no, nobody's gonna buy that.
Yeah, see, that's what we were conditioned for. Like, it's a very, very different mentality now. But at the same time, I feel like we're better socialized. I don't know. I watch some of these teenagers who can't even fucking go ask somebody for napkins at a restaurant, and I'm like,
bro, you're just asking for napkins.
Yeah, you just but they actually have social anxiety about speaking to a human in real life. And I'm like, seriously, dude, just like, we need some napkins.
Yeah.
And you're the child here. You have to do the chore. Like when we were kids, we were the errand runners. Now you get to go get that shit. Bye.
Yeah. What if I want someone else to do it? Grow up and have kids. God damn it. I don't want to do that.
Yeah, no, I still get my own napkins, but I'm happy to get my own napkins. But when I'm with my friends, I do ask their children to go do shit. I'm like, go refill that for me, please. Thank you. Right. Yes, you're young and able. I know I'm a dancer, but my knees are shit. I don't care. I got to save it.
It'd be like that. Like you hit a certain age and then like your knees are like, oh God. And then your back's like, I'm going to compensate for it by doing this. And your back's like, oh God, it's not supposed to do this. And your shoulders are like, wait a minute. Dude, I can make up for this somehow, right?
I'm pretty sure that's what's fucking happening to me with my conditions, because I was under really good control for like a while, for years. I was like, everything was chill. I was like, cool. I'm on the right combo of supplements. I was off prescription meds. I was really thrilled. And Yeah. And then I honestly, I think it's just age. I think age, because like my doctor was even looking me in the face and she was like, yeah, you do everything right. She looked at me straight in the face. She was like, you do everything right. You eat right. You exercise all the time. You do all these things. You do all the right things. Your body just hates you. I was like,
As it does. But
as it
yeah,
does.
no, like, friggin', I've been picking on my wife about that because she's been 29 for a few years now.
Sure.
And on one hand, it's kind of cool because I keep getting older and she stays the same age. But then it was like one day I was like, hey, can you be 16? And she's like, God damn it. God damn it. Well, no.
Doesn't go that way.
Well, no. I found like when we moved, I found like one of her like high school, like senior portrait like things that was still around and like taped it up in my Jeep. And then she gets in there and she's like, so what's Jailbait Mallory doing in here? I'm like, help me drive. What do you think? She's like,
What do you? I love you. I was.
what?
What? I'm showing off my wife. What's your problem? She's like, yeah, 16-year-old wife. What's your problem?
We live in the woods, man. Like that's par for the course. Come on.
Yeah. Well, and honestly, it's like, well, that yeah, I was that age at the same time you were that age, so or roughly that age, and. Yeah, though I don't have the same, my husband's 10 years older than me, so he doesn't look it. He looks very young. He actually lied to me about his age when we first met, and I believed him. That's what he, I found out years into our relationship. Years.
Years.
It never came up because, like, I don't want kids, so I don't really give a shit, about, I just didn't give a shit. And then one day I was talking to my sister-in-law, and she was saying that like her husband turned a certain age, and I was, and her husband is the younger brother, and I was like, wait, I thought Ace was the youngest of the, and she was like, he is. Ace is 3 years younger than Gunner, and I was like, okay.
All right. See what you're doing over here.
All right. I was like, all right. And she, and the thing is, I had so much fun though, because I fucked with him. Because he didn't know if I was gonna be angry or not about that. Frankly, it was one of those things, like when we first met, even before we started dating, when we first met, he actually lied to me about his age. And he did it because he actually thought I was much younger than I am, which huge compliment, yay, thank you me. But like he thought I was like 10 or 15 younger years younger than I actually am, so he lied about how
So
old
you
he
put it back in
was.
perspective and you're like, wait a minute, you thought I was 14?
Now, he thought I was like
Here's some
25.
questions for you, pal.
Yeah, he thought I was like 25 when we met, and I was not. I was in my 30s. I was, and I and he was and he was in his early 40s when we met. But yeah, I found out, but I fucked because I knew my sister-in-law would tell her husband and he would immediately tell Gunner. And so I was like, oh, I'm gonna nurse this. And I just watched him walk on eggshells for days. And for several days, I'd be like, oh, I wanted to talk to you about something. And he'd be like, oh shit. And he'd be like, okay, like this is the conversation. I'd be like, yeah, I was thinking maybe we should go to dinner at this place, or you feel like Chinese tonight? What's that? And he would be like, oh, and so I did that for like 3 or 4 days straight. And he just was like, and he would get all tense and then he would land. I in my head, I'm enjoying myself very much and having a good time. And then finally, huh?
It's all about the entertainment factor.
It for me, I enjoyed it. Because I don't give a shit how old he is. I don't like I don't. But then I waited until because then he was on edge and he was just expecting it to come at any time. So I waited until he was really relaxed, like right we were in bed. Both of us were sitting there fucking around on our phones instead of reading books like people do these days. And he was completely like, I finally saw him like, and I was like, so you're this age. And he was like, oh shit. And
You can't be doing that.
was just, and he was like, are you mad? I was like, no, I don't give a shit. But I did have fun for the past week.
Well, I mean, like speaking of that age difference, I poke fun of that in, the books because like when Hank and Penelope meet, Hank's like 23-ish and she's 87, I think, but she's an alien, so she looks like she's, you know, whatever.
Right, yeah, it's like, whatever.
There's that part in the second book where, you know, fucking she says something snarky about them doing stuff in bed, and he goes, yeah, you know, sometimes I feel like I'm robbing the grave banging somebody as old as you.
Well, you know, that's, yeah. Actually, in The Queen Witch, Jeeve, from the first book, he actually finds love, but it's with a half-elf. And you know, so she's like a couple hundred years younger than him.
Also, for context, people, The Queen Witch is the second book in her Rashan series. I don't remember that on the live or not. We were talking about before the show.
Yes, we did. Yeah. We did. No, you mentioned it on the live. You did.
I did. Okay.
I don't know. Maybe you did. Well, yeah, I write a fantasy series called the Rashan series because I don't remember either. And actually, here. Yeah. This is the first one, and then The Queen Witch is the second one, and I'm talking about The Queen Witch.
Also, did you put those in a different format? Because I don't remember the first one being that thick.
So I'm really proud. It's the same story. I edited it, but now we've got maps.
Nice.
We got a shit ton more graphics. And of course, I redid the cover, and I did like a whole bunch of things, like a pronunciation guide for the characters.
I have to buy it again. God damn it, Hollis! I have to buy it again.
It is cooler. It is this version is like much prettier, and now like The Queen Witch is this way too. But like all the chapters have a graphic and a title.
Okay.
Yeah, so you can't really see the graphic because it's very like kind of cool faded on the stream, but. Yeah, so like an entire page is like chapter this, and then you dive into what it is. So it's the same story, but the page count is upped because I put so many fucking pictures in here, which I know you appreciate.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I like my first cover a lot, but I needed it to look like a cohesive series.
Yeah. That gets real fucking annoying when you get like a series and the books are formatted different. And it's like, stick with it, man. Come on, bro. But also for those of you at home, I would liken her first book, The Save a World, to a D&D campaign.
Which is what it was. Yeah.
Yeah. So if you're into that, that's this episode's book recommendation.
To Save a World. Available fucking everywhere. Woo! One day I'll get an audiobook together. People tell me I should do it myself, and I'm like,
it's super easy. There's like no work involved. Like you just have to like find time when you know the spouse and dogs aren't making a bunch of noise and there's no traffic or helicopters or the neighbor's not mowing the lawn or anything. And then if you want to make it interesting, you have to get really good at voice acting and or you know hire other people to do it for you. And then if you want to splice it yourself, that's you got to get good at audio editing. So
I have all that shit. I don't know how you do all that shit. I am like fucking tired. I just listening to it, I'm just like I don't know. I already do well, and you know I work full-time in addition to writing, and like I'm just like fuck me.
I mean it was a good experience. And you know I'm gonna start doing it again here soon. I've got most of the not most, about half the voice work in for the second book, and you're doing a voice.
Yes, I am. I am. I need to. I had a little sinus infection, so I was like, I'm not gonna record while I'm doing it. Like it's gonna sound like shit. I'm not doing that. So it's clearing up now. Yeah. So I will record. Actually, maybe this Sunday.
Okay.
I need to do a podcast episode because I need to. I'm going to go down to one podcast episode a month because I just like fucking.
Well, it's a lot. It's a lot of content you got to fucking create, you know?
It's a lot of content and time. Even if you do it like me, where I just like fly, and you're like me, like we don't fucking practice. It's just like fly by the seat of your pants, go. And it works.
Well, no, I mean, because that's the other thing too. Because like, you know, with my voice actors and shit, you know, I ask everybody to give me like, you know, two takes because like inevitably a dog's going to bark in the middle of a fucking sentence. I don't care how good you are at fucking making sure that a dog doesn't bark in the middle of a sentence. Somewhere a dog's going to bark in the middle of a fucking sentence. So, you know, please too. But then also, like, I'll get other people's shit together. And like when I record it, I will type in my password onto my computer because my screen turned off. But you know, I'll also, you know, do two or three of everything also. That way, once I get the voice actor shit in there, you know, I can be like, all right, well, if this person's saying this like this, and this person's saying that like that, and these are the best two takes, mine will flow better if I use this take between theirs to make it make sense, instead of one person being like this, another person being, I don't know, like this. Oh, and then, you know, you got to have a bridge coming in there somewhere that, you know, ties it together to where that makes sense with everyone's diction and tone, you know. So it's like fucking, I don't know, like most chapters are about like what, 20-ish minutes long. There's fucking I don't know, 8 hours of fucking work that goes into each one of those bitches.
Oh, there'd have to be. Yeah. And I mean, and on top of all of that that you just mentioned, like just the idea of, because I know when I was recording for you, I just read like I would say my line and then I would read the other character's line silently in my head, like as in the, you know, cadence and everything that I thought that they would be saying it speed wise. And then I would say my thing again. I was trying to give appropriate amounts of time in between.
Yeah.
Hoping that would help. But I was like, I don't know if this makes any difference or if he's just going to fucking splice it together.
Cut it the hell up.
Yeah.
But I do appreciate when people do that though, because the people that don't, we'll finish a line and then immediately start another line and then do the next line. It's like, dude, you have to give me like 2 fucking seconds, man.
Yeah. But, well, just to know, like, I don't know. It is your book, but at the same time, you've written 11 fucking books at this point. You don't remember the pattern of conversation for each one. You're like, I don't know. Did they stop talking yet? Hold on. Let me recheck the script.
Yeah. Well, and then one of the other thing though, is I didn't give people a whole lot of direction for shit they should do. Like in the like, you know, with the voice, beyond like, oh hey, this is their personality, you know, go with it, because I thought, and I think it paid off, that like someone's gonna bring their own individual fucking twist to it, mm-hmm. and that makes it more I don't know, flow more naturally, I guess would be the thing. Like there's the character fucking Gladewine, and mm-hmm. nobody pronounces her name the same way.
Kit Kat.
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah.
But the thing is about that though, is that's realistic to like Marine Corps shit. Cause if you're in the military, you got your name written here, mm-hmm. and how I interpret how that's supposed to be pronounced is what your fucking name is now. And right. like I knew multiple people who had 16 different fucking names. Well, not 16, but like, you know, 5 different names. And it was just how somebody pronounced the fucking alphabet soup on your chest, you know?
Yeah. Well, and honestly, that's why I decided to do a pronunciation guide in To Save a World the second time around, because like no one knew how to say Ethne. Like no one knew. I don't know. Like, I don't know why. To me, maybe it's because I'm half Scottish. Like it was a name that I had heard before growing up. Yeah. Like it was normal to my mind. But other people were like, I've never fucking seen this collection of letters ever. Like, it didn't make any sense, and they did not know what to say.
Yeah, and I think I got Yasalin right, but that was just because, like, right before I read that book, I don't remember if I, like, met somebody somewhere or if I just saw somebody, like, in a TV show or something, but they pronounced Jasmine as Yasmina.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, you can do a soft J in things that aren't Spanish?
Yeah.
Wait, no. Half of Europe speaks Latin languages. That makes a lot of sense. Shit. I gotta go reevaluate how I fucking read. But going back to, actually, I don't remember if this was on the stream or beforehand, the whole, like, I've never seen that word before. That's how it's gonna be pronounced, and I'm gonna pronounce this word that way until I hear someone else say it somehow else, like you were saying with your lady, not Lucrezia.
Lucretia.
Yeah. Yeah, Lucretia. I thought that was Lucretia.
See, well, and I can see that. Yeah. But it's just like, yeah, honestly, well, and you know, I'm not one of those people, I do not get bent out of shape about how people, because it's a book, for fuck's sake. And I put the pronunciation guide in out of people asking me a lot. They're like, no, I want to say it right. And I'm like, just read it however your brain likes to read it. And they're just like,
you can call Ethne Bob for all the fuck I care. Just write it a goddamn review once you're done, please.
Yeah, please, for fuck's sake, write a review. PSA. Oh, are you done? He's done now. He's done with affection. That's all he needed.
Well, he was.
That's the cat. He gets a little jealous when I'm on like Zoom or something with anybody. He's just like, wait a minute. It's my time all the time. Yeah. But I'm just like, I did the pronunciation guide because people just kept fucking asking me. And they would pronounce Jeeve as Giev, which I totally get. I just like, because I made that name up, but I wrote it like in my head for whatever reason, I thought of, you know, Kiev.
Yeah.
Instead, because you pronounce it Kiev. And
oh, Kiev.
Yeah.
And then like after the Russian invasion, it's like, oh no, it's not Kiev, it's Kiev. It's like, dude, you're spelling two different words, but like you pronounce that Kiev. And yeah. Then you watch it on TV and you're like, oh, wait, was it always like that? Or did I only ever read that fucking name on a map for the last however many?
Yeah, I've always, and I don't know if it's just like, you know, I'm a military brat. I lived abroad since I was a baby. Like my first passport, my mother had to hold me up because I couldn't hold my own head up yet. Like it was like me in my mom's lap, like... fucking baby, but so I always just pronounced it Kiev, but like, and so when I was writing Jeeve, I don't know why I just spelled it like that, but with a G.
Yeah.
Instead, yeah, and so everybody says Giev, and I'm like, okay, let me just put this because nobody says it right, and I don't care, but everybody gets upset when they're like, do you mean Giev? And I was like, oh, actually, I say Jeeve. And they're like, oh, no. And I'm like, I don't care.
Well, I mean, that's the other thing, though, is everyone calls him Aristotle, but that restaurant's called Chipotle.
Yeah.
Mm. So Aristotle over here fucking spit this fucking goddamn.
Well, and then you have two different language origins, too. So, well, maybe. I don't know, because the...
What, in English? In English, we got at least three, because, like,
we got German.
Germanic, especially for like short, like one syllable words, and then a lot of the rest of it's Latin that comes over from French from the Norman conquest.
Yeah,
but because of, you know, highbrow fucking like education shit, you know, there's also a lot of Greek that comes over because, you know, that's what the monks would write in. And if you wanted to,
if you're in Europe anywhere and you speak a language, there is Greek somewhere in your fucking, like, the ancient Greek or Latin is in there somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's just how it is. But it's, I mean, yeah, and English is a fucked up language. That's something that a lot of native speakers don't realize. Is like, I taught English. It's been many years, but I am actually a TEFL certified instructor internationally. Way back in the day, I used to teach English in the Czech Republic. And it's like, English is messed up. When I was learning how to teach English, they were like, okay, so other languages have like these three simple rules, and English has these 1,500 very complicated rules with 10 exceptions each. And I was like, okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, from what I understand, like Mandarin Chinese is the hardest one to learn, and then it's English. And the only reason Mandarin's harder is because you can say the same word, but like your inflection in that word changes its meaning, which is why it kind of sounds like Chinese people are singing when they speak.
Yeah, it's, and I actually took 3 years of Mandarin in college, and that's exactly it. Mandarin Chinese, from a written standpoint or just grammatically speaking, is fucking simple. They only have one tense. They don't even have past or future tense. They only have present tense. If you want to say something happened in the past, you say 3 days ago. They don't even have plurals.
Huh.
They don't even have plural. They have one present simple tense, period, and then they have no plural. If you want to say something is more than one, you say the number. You say three peaches or whatever it is, or three peach, which is why when a lot of native Chinese speakers are speaking English, they don't speak in plurals. They'll say three peach or whatever because it doesn't exist in their language.
Yeah. See, I was lazy about that. So like when I went to college, which I didn't go to school till I got out of the Marine. So I was like fucking 30 something. Right.
Right.
And we had to take a language for, you know, our major, which pissed me off because it wasn't a certain language. It could be any language. And if it's like, well, if it's not a certain language, then how does that fucking apply? Like I can understand if I'm going into art history and you want me to learn, I don't know, Latin or German because of the high Renaissance shit. But like, why is Korean a fucking option if I want to do that? But anyway, long story short, I took German because I didn't want to learn another language. And then everybody will tell you, oh, German and English aren't the same language. And it's like, yeah, dude, I am like
three semesters into this.
It's the same fucking language.
It's a different accent.
Yeah, I mean, the grammar's different. And I appreciate their grammar a little bit more, but yeah, it's the same fucking language.
It's the same fucking language. I remember when I was a kid and we were in Europe fucking somewhere, I don't know, but we turned on the TV and I found German cartoons. And as a child who spoke no German, I understood the German cartoons.
Yeah.
It was, you know, and I not word for word, but no, I totally got the plot. I knew what was happening. Like, it's very easy to understand.
Yeah. I mean, and it doesn't help that like most of the fucking like operative fucking shit's the same. And like, you know, if you listen to a fucking sentence in it and you know, like, you don't have to know what anything about context clues. You just have to know what context clues are.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, all right. So he wants that person to do something with the tea and it's hot.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. That's all you have. But English is, well, and English is more difficult too, because it's still a living language. Like, we are still adding words to this shit.
Yeah.
And like, most other languages are technically considered dead languages. Like, you can't, like, people come up with slangs and everything, but officially nothing gets added. Officially, yeah, the language is done. You know, yeah, like, you don't add to their dictionary, you don't change the grammar, but English, we're still fucking changing things. Like, when we were growing up, when we were kids, they taught us that the plural of fish is also fish.
Yeah, but now it can be fishes.
But now, about 15 years ago, because so many people were incorrectly saying it, they just were like, just put it in there. Just do it.
Like, yeah.
And it was only because so many people were incorrectly saying it. It wasn't anything else. They were like, we give up. Fine.
Y'all win. Fuck it.
Yep. And that's happened with so many. Like, I think
it's funny, though, too, because like, it's easy to like say that, like, that's the fault of Americans speaking English. But like, I don't know if you've ever met anybody from, I don't know, England, Scotland, Ireland.
Oh, I'm going to England
again. Canada, Australia, fucking anywhere else that speaks English. They're just as bad about like, okay, so this isn't a word, I'm using it.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a word. Oh, and the Brits get indignant about it. It's like, yeah, that's not a word. Well, it's our country's language, so it is.
Yeah. Yeah, we get to say what we want. And Shakespeare made up fucking half of the words in his plays. Just, you know, blatantly was like, I don't care. It's a word now. Like, there's so many words we have just because Shakespeare decided to make shit up. Like,
did you know that Shakespeare also came up with the I fucked your mom joke?
No!
Yeah.
He did?
Yeah. Now, how about this? Let me rephrase that. We don't know for a fact that he invented the I fucked your mom thing.
But there's no
evidence of anyone else using I fucked your mom as a derogatory idiom before Shakespeare. So it might have existed before that. It's just the longest surviving. Hey, yeah, no, I fucked your mom. Actually, no, I have done thy mother.
I love if he was the one who wrote it down first, great. Yeah, yeah, I fucking love that. That makes me like Shakespeare more. And I already like Shakespeare a lot. I like his comedies. I mean, the tragedies are great, fine, but I honestly love the comedies. His early work is some of my favorite.
Yeah. Like, one of them that, like, the first time I read The Tempest, I was like, this is dumb. I don't get it. This is stupid. And then, like, thank God for, like, the No Fear Shakespeare people, where it's like, all right, here's the original shit that you're not going to read. Here's it in English with cliff notes. And it's like, oh!
I love it now!
You naughty bitch!
That's the thing. Like, when you're a kid in school and whatever, they edited it. And so Shakespeare was kind of fucking boring. But then when you actually get to read the real play, you're like, oh look at this shit talk. I love it. You know, and it's very murdery and raunchy, and it is scandalous. And that's, I mean, honestly, if Queen Elizabeth hadn't loved his work, he probably would have gotten executed.
Yeah.
He would have gotten executed for sure, actually. But he got away with it because the queen loved his shit. So power to him.
Yeah, no, and it's kind of a funny thing with him, too. Because, like, there was, like, you know, he was by far not the only playwright around back then.
Oh, no, there were tons.
And the other guys, like, have, like, a two-paragraph Wikipedia page. And, like, if you want to read their shit, you got to, like, go to projectgutenberg.com or org, which, by the way, that's a good really resource for, like, you know, reading not copyrighted material fucking books. Because their whole thing is like, hey, dude, any book we can get on here is going to be on here. But, like, you even go to them, and they're like the Wikipedia of fucking online books. And these other playwrights are like, all right, so here's it in fucking Middle English. Have fun, kid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I remember the Chanceworth, the Canterbury Tales. That's what I'm thinking. Jeffrey Chanceworth. The other Chance, the cool Chanceworth.
No.
Or Chance. Oh, God, I've got this wrong. I'm saying her.
Chaucer.
Thank you. Oh, my God. Chaucer. I am shamed for like my history. I swear I have a history degree. A specialization is in ancient cultures, whatever.
Well, it's all right. Mine's in art, so like it counts for dick.
But if you read the like Chaucer, the old English, I remember I was in a rare book room, which is, you know, heaven in a lot of ways. And they had a 1500s copy. I forget exactly what year, but it was from the 1500s Canterbury Tales. And I had the white gloves on and I was allowed to look through, and I was trying and I was reading it. And I like, and it wasn't that I couldn't read it. Like I could read the handwriting, but yeah. I was like, ah, shit. I thought I was good at this language.
You know what's funny about like that part of Middle English though is like if you read it in your head, it's all fucked up and you don't know what it is. But if you pronounce it, it makes sense. Like,
yeah,
you know, hey, what are you eating for breakfast? A-G-G-E-S. Angus? Eggs? Eggs? He's eating eggs? And it's like, I mean, you kind of have to say it like you're, you know, backwater redneck, which, by the way, due to the vowel shift, people in Shakespeare's time spoke like stereotypical like fucking West Virginians back then. So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Take that, England. But
yeah, so you know, in a few hundred years, maybe the people, because I well, you know, I live here in Georgia, and so maybe the people down here are going to sound all British and fancy, and who knows what the Brits will sound like then.
Well, yeah, no, it'd be interesting to see what America sounds like in the different regions in, say, you know, 1,000 years, because, like, you know, originally they think that, you know, all European and Asian and Middle Eastern languages, you know, came from like what Indo-European or whatever.
Yeah Indo-Germanic or European or something.
Yeah, and then like evolved, you know, out of that. And it's like, okay, so at some point English, Latin, Swedish and Korean were the same base language, and then just, you know, took forever to sprawl out. So it's like, I want to talk to somebody in Miami, someone in Alaska, and somebody in Ottawa, and you know what, throw New Orleans in there, see if they just like they just went back to French. Okay. All right.
Yeah. And it's all, well, and I don't know, pronunciations are really cool and it's different and language is fun. I'm not necessarily good at it, but I do enjoy it. I feel the same way about language as I do about science. I'm not necessarily good at it, but shit, I love to learn it. Like, tell me the things and I'll learn as much as I'll listen, but I am not good at discovering the things. So I mean, I don't know. I used to speak more languages. I am so fucking out of practice. No, I need to go back to Italy and refresh myself. Well, and honestly, it's just you know, you go out, you live. I don't know. I need to go. One of my best friends is she's a 76-year-old Sicilian woman with bright purple hair. I fucking love her. Her name is Tina. I have coffee with her every Saturday.
Where are you from again?
Well, so I'm a Navy brat.
That your parents get coffee?
My parents are both born and raised in Connecticut.
Okay.
So we got the New England twang
okay.
a little bit. And if I, you know, so, and my, you know, my mother's 100% Italian, and she is like first generation Italian in this country. So it's like, we got the super accent. And it comes out in me every once in a while, because even though I bounced around all my life, like, you know, I was raised by New England parents. Yeah. But it's just, I forget where I was going with that. Tina.
Yeah.
She is awesome. And she is fluent in like 5 languages, right? She of course is fluent in English. She's lived here. They immigrated here when she was 13 years old. her to Brooklyn, New York. Her father was a legit baker, like with the brick ovens. So
she speaks Italian, English, and that weird bullshit they speak in Brooklyn, and like fluently in between the three.
Yeah, well, and Sicilian, which a lot of people don't realize is not Italian. No, Sicilian not. Is similar, but it's not the same thing. And so she, of course, is fluent in her native language of Sicilian. She's fluent in Italian. She's fluent in Spanish. She's, of course, fluent in English. And I think she speaks Dutch. She speaks one other thing. But yeah, she's amazing. And I'm like, I need to practice my Italian with my friend. And she, and I like, well, and I'll talk to her sometimes, but then I'm like, oh shit, I need my dictionary. Hold on. Hold on. I forgot the word. I have to bring a textbook with me to have an Italian conversation now. I feel like, just throw me in Italy, give me a lot of pasta, and I'll get back into it. I'll relearn.
Yeah. That's one of those things. Like, yeah, Italy's on my list of places to go to, but it has nothing to do with the culture. I want to go look at some architecture and like, have to lie about what I ate.
Yeah. Just eat your way through that country. Honestly, it's fucking amazing. Yeah. That's all you need to do, and visit Hadrian's Villa, Tivoli, the gardens and everything outside of Roma. It's so, yeah. Whenever you're going, you let me know, because I actually wrote a guidebook for Italy, for Tuscany. Oh. I did. It's published by my university. When my university wanted, like, so you know when you're graduating from college, at least as a history major, you have to do an internship, like, thing. And I didn't like any of the internships they had available for my senior year. I was like, I don't want to do any of those things, and none of them pertain to my major. So
again, like, why are you making me do some shit that has nothing to do with the educational part of why the fuck I'm here in the first place? Why exactly do I need a doctorate to fucking work at a library?
Yeah,
I'm sorry, go on.
Yeah, well, no, and so, well, and I just, me always, like, you know, the name of my podcast is I Do What I Want, because I fucking do what I want, and I just was like, well, I don't want to do that, I want to do this, and so I created a proposal, and I went to the chair of the history department, and I was like, I want to go on the study abroad in Italy. I will write a guidebook for the study abroad for the students. I already, at the time, I spoke Italian pretty proficiently. And I was like, I will help the professors along the way. I'll be the assistant to all the professors, da, da. And I want that to be my internship, because my specialization is the ancient Etruscans of Italy. Yeah. And so I should be in fucking Tuscany for my internship. And he loved it. He was like, write me a proposal. He had me present to the fucking board. By the way, almost 20 years later, because that was 2005, they still have that internship program in effect, almost with the exact same parameters that I created.
Nice.
Yeah, go team. So, I mean, obviously the guidebook, they don't have to rewrite it, but they do amend it.
Yeah.
Yeah, obviously they've had to amend it because...
You have to contribute something. You can't just go there and get drunk and eat pasta and bang Italian dudes, as much as that's what we want to do.
As much as it's fun.
You actually need some work while you're over there.
Don't forget the coffee, though. You need to drink all the espresso, and it's very delicious, and you do that. But yeah, that was really cool. So I did that, and I just had a great time. And I frankly did spend most of my time just like, because I decided the terms for the guidebook too. So I was like, oh, well, you know what? People are going to, one of them was a field trip guide. So I was like, well, I'm going to have to visit all these places to write the field trip guide appropriately.
Yeah. I mean, so that only makes sense.
It only makes sense. So, and I already, you know, and I got into for free with a lot of the field trips, because the field trips are where the professors wanted me along with them to speak Italian to the people. Yeah. And so they were like, well, would you like to come see Michelangelo's David for free? And I was like, yes, I would. Thank you. I would like to see that. I would like to go to the Vatican on your dime. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All of that. Yeah. So it was great.
That reminds me of a story though. Oh shit, we're past our time limit.
So oh damn, yeah, we're almost 10 minutes over. Oops.
Yeah, you tell me when you want to go. But going back to, or speaking of Italians, and going back to the whole like old language where you have to like say it out loud to, you know, understand what it says, mm-hmm. was like ancient Latin. Like it was written in a way to where like you really couldn't read it. You had to like say it out loud, like while you're looking at it to pronounce it and know what was being said. And one of the many reasons that people didn't trust Julius Caesar was because he could read silently without saying the words out loud.
Oh.
Yeah, so, you know, that was an issue because this guy knows things. Is that witchcraft or what's up with that, buddy? But he's sitting in Senate one day, and one of his political enemies is up, you know, on the stage, you know, ranting and raving, doing the whatever. I think it was Cato. I might be wrong about
that. Cato was definitely a rival, yeah. And they, yeah.
Yeah. But he's sitting in Senate, and he's sitting there, and somebody comes in and hands Julius Caesar a note. Julius Caesar looks at it, puts it in his toga, and sits back down. And, you know, Cato goes, you know, like, oh, blah, 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 whatever. Look at this guy. He's taking these secret notes because he can read silently. Yeah, I bet you don't want to, you know, read that note out loud. You know, reveal your conspiracies. And Julius Caesar's like, you know, I kind of want to read it out loud, but you don't want me to. And Cato's like, do it. So Cato gets up and reads this passionate love letter from Cato's sister about how he needs to come over and fucking just disgustingly split her in half. And then once he's done, he's like, you got anything else you want me to read? And Cato's like, sit the fuck down. God damn it.
Nope. I don't. Yeah. See, and that's one of the other things I loved about ancient Roman politics is that murder, totally legal. If you wanted to take out your opponent just by like publicly fucking murdering them, that was a legitimate way to take out your political opponent during election times.
Yeah. Well, one of my favorite was the proscriptions, which was where you made it illegal to try people on the proscriptions list. I'm sorry. If someone's on the proscriptions list, if someone else kills them, it's illegal to charge that person for murder.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's like, all right, so it's just kind of like illegal for these guys to be around right now. Have fun, kids.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a lot of people don't realize how violent. Like, I mean, everybody knows the Romans were violent, let's be honest, and actually ignited about, because it's historical fantasy. But it's basically the Roman invasion of Britain in 43 AD.
Yeah. And then like, if you read about ancient Roman stuff, like in the detail of it, instead of just, you know, these guys did this, that, whatever. It's like, okay, so this makes Game of Thrones look like Barney the fucking dinosaur.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. They don't even fucking know. I'm just like, have you seen these dudes? Like they were like locusts, man. just went.
No. And then my favorite was this guy named, depending on where you're from, it's either Sulla or Sulla. And, you know, he kind of like ended their first like big civil war. But he's one of the generals. And like back in the day, you couldn't have the army in Rome. And what he does, he marched the army into the Rome. And then he stopped Senate from existing.
Yeah.
Over the course of a couple hours. If you catch my drift, censors. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And then like after he was like supreme dictator for like a week, he's like, all right, I'm going to go to the mountains and get drunk and hunt for the rest of my life. Might get a skin disease. I don't know. And then like historians hate him because like, so you forcefully took over Rome and all you did was kill Senate and then fuck off. Like you could have done so much, man. It's like, yeah, I just wanted to hunt and drink, and Senate was getting in the way of me hunting and drinking. This is extremely simplified for those of you at home. But
But honestly, a lot of it, the motives were very base in most cases. They were just like, I just want this thing. All of you shut up now. I'm going to hobo murder you and it will be over.
And then like he fucking killed Senate and then he put all their families on the prescriptions list. So it's like, hey, if you want to take their house, it's illegal for the authorities, which I should probably set that up before I leave. It will be illegal for the cops to arrest you for that after I make new cops, because there aren't cops either. I kill a lot of people. Yeah. Hey, you guys, you're all senators now. Don't fuck up or I'll be back. All right. Yeah, hey, me and Merriman, we're going to fucking whatever's in North Italy.
Yeah. It was purge time in Rome. That's exactly what it was, to put a modern spin on it. It was purge time in Rome. You had a finite amount of time and do whatever you wanted. Enjoy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's good times. Though also getting back to sex jokes real quick, the split in half reminded me of a 1920s slang for that act. You know what they used to call it?
What's up?
Beard splitting.
Are we talking about a beard or a beard?
Beard.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah. Yeah. The 1920 slang for going and doing that was beard splitting, which I always, you reminded me when you used that particular paraphrasing and I was like, oh yeah.
I'm going to Boston. I'm going to eat me some bearded clam.
Going beard splitting tonight. And it's like, oh, what does that mean?
Oh my God, this is so dirty. I know, I did that Tuesday. Okay, never mind.
Back in the day, man. Back in the day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, there's like so many fucking euphemisms for that. And then like the more creative you get with it, the more people you piss off. Like the two ones that come to mind immediately that like bother people are if you say that you eat pussy like cervical cancer, people get mad about that.
It's awful.
And then the other one is like, I'm sure you've ran into somebody like this before where it's some dude that like thinks he's like too good to like, you know, go down on a chick.
Right.
And you're like, wait, so you don't like eating pussy? No. Do you want dick instead? What are you, gay? And they're like,
yeah, they're getting all very offended. And it's like, dude, you know, you're
the one that said you didn't like pussy, dude. Fuck. I don't know.
Like, yeah, it's like,
if you want to be like that, it's cool, man. I'm not dogging you. Just, yeah. You know.
Yeah.
Apparently you like dick, man. Fuck.
Well, my answer used to be, well, you must not like getting your dick sucked. Sorry.
Yeah.
Equal opportunity over here. Because I'm not doing it if you're not.
No, that reminded me, to wrap this back down to the fucking beginning of the fucking conversation. So the way I met my wife, right? I had one of my junior Marines get killed in Afghanistan. It was like at the end of the deployment. So, you know, we could go home for the fucking funeral. Cause most of the time you don't get to do that. Right.
Right.
So we go to the funeral and the dude's mom gets mad at us because we had the audacity to get a hotel instead of just assume that we could crash at her place. And we're like, all right, we didn't think that was going to be a thing, but sure. We'll just stay at your house. And oh, you guys are that kind of Catholic. Listen, I've been in the Marine Corps for a few years. I'm not used to drinking like this.
Mm-hmm.
And if you know anybody in the military, it's a lot. Anyway, fucking, I get blackout drunk. I'm at a wake.
Fuck.
Well,
that's very Catholic. You know, as a Catholic military brat, yeah, that's super Catholic.
I get blackout drunk and awake. And I come to, and I'm on the back of somebody else's car making out with some chick. And then, like, that's when I come back into reality. I'm like, oh, fuck, hold on. Who are you? You want to go get Denny's tomorrow? Okay, I'll see you then. And yeah, it worked out.
It worked out. Denny's is for winners. Good, you know. Denny's is for closers, actually. That's pretty, you closed on that. Good job.
The thing is, though, it's like Denny's is a fucking weird thing because, like, if you go there for like breakfast at like 9 o'clock in the morning on the weekend, it's like I am gonna judge you for that.
Yeah, that's
not when you Denny's is the fucking place to be at 3 o'clock in the fucking morning.
Get yourself a fucking Grand Slam. Yeah, like
it's so popular.
It is. Well, and you know, I remember I went to a friend's wedding like in Dallas around the time that the Hobbit movies were out. And the hotel that we stayed at was across the street from a Denny's. So, of course, we were like fucking Denny's every day because that's what we're doing. They had a Hobbit menu that I wish they would bring back. It was amazing.
All right.
I don't even remember everything, but they had just like everything was just laden and it was piles of food on top of food with all sorts of like pancakes and French toast.
Like you're getting breakfast and second breakfast at the same fucking time, motherfucker. Yeah.
It was so much and like honey and shit. And like, I'm a big sweet tooth person. So I was like, are you putting honey on my like bacon and shit? Oh, hell, you know, like I was just like, yeah. Do all of it, do all of it. And it was just like everything. And they
also sweet tooth fucking little hack for you. Fucking tablespoonful of honey. Just eat it. And then whatever shot, like do a shot of like vitamin D fucking milk.
Oh, okay. I do like milk and honey quite a lot. I'm going to.
But anyway, back to Hobbits. So with Hobbits, concerning Hobbits, an issue concerning Hobbits. First off, Red Lord of the Rings, they tell you how to make most of the food in there, right?
Yeah, they do.
And there's also this like murder rampage on the in-between. If you've ever looked up how to make fucking something on the internet, somebody fucking will tell you their whole entire goddamn life story before they tell you how much fucking pepper to put in fucking scrambled eggs. So J.R.R. Tolkien was just a modern recipe fucking guy.
Yeah, he was like fucking Bobby Flay, but an author with fantasy.
Way before his time. Way before his time.
Yeah, yeah. Oh god, he was way before his time in a lot of ways. But yeah, I need to make shit again because I actually made some of those Lord of the Rings recipes years ago. And you know, it's like the 20th anniversary of the films that came out.
Those came out like 2 years ago.
Yeah, I'm sorry. You're right. Absolutely.
Apologies. It's 2009 right now, right?
But we are still so young. So very young.
Isn't that weird though? Like, because like, you know, back when you were a kid, you're like fucking 20 years ago. That was like World War II, right? And now you're like, yeah, 20 years ago was.
I was an adult.
Tuesday.
Mm-hmm. I was an adult. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a little tough to swallow. Yeah. Actually, at Dragon Con this year, Sean Astin, Elijah Wood were both there, and Andy Serkis.
Really?
Yeah, they were all there. I had it. Okay, so I actually got to meet Sean Astin a few years ago, and I got a picture with him. Super nice guy. Like, amazing. Everything they say about him is true. He's a wonderful human. That's Elijah funny. Wood, I've never actually gotten to meet because, of course, the crowd around him was fucking huge. Yeah. But I did get to see him, and I was like, oh, because he was, honestly, he was probably one of my first celebrity crushes because he's about my age. And, like, we were the same. So I saw a little boy that was, like, the same as me on the movie, and I, like, had a crush on him. And I just, like, my mother had to be like, you cannot see The Good Son. You remember that movie? Like, she was like, you are too young to see The Good Son. No, I know that Elijah Wood is in it, but you need to calm yourself down. No. Like, there was a lot of shit that I wanted to see that he was in. And mom was like, why does this child actor keep making scary films? But yeah. But I saw him in person. And he looks exactly like Elijah Wood, but it was cool.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that is weird though, thinking back on it though, like what movies you're allowed to watch and not, and the reasons why.
Mm-hmm.
And we had this conversation on live, so we don't need to do it again.
We don't need to do it again. But basically, in my case, a lot of the time it was my parents were not paying, not that they weren't paying attention, but like Watership Down happened because my dad saw cartoon bunnies and he was like, must be cool, go for it.
Yeah.
And then the other shit happened.
Did you ever see a movie called Wizards?
Oh my god. I think I did. That sounds super familiar.
So there is these two warring factions in this like big Dungeons and Dragons type fantasy world. It was Ralph Bakshi. It was the same guy that did the old Hobbit movie.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
And the goblins and demons kept coming up. And
yeah, oh my god.
They couldn't win. So what they did, because like every time they had a victory, they fell apart. So like the evil wizard like found this old library of like old Nazi propaganda and then like, you know, kind of turned the orcs into the Third Reich or the Fourth Reich or whatever.
Oh my god.
The good wizard was friends with the fairy and they went to go destroy the evil wizard, which was his brother. And, you know, they go and they do their thing and, you know, the good guys kind of come out on top. But then at the end of it, it stops with, you know, the good guy wizard and the bad guy wizard who are brothers and they're shooting fireballs and shit at each other. And then, the good guy wizard who's down on his back and about to lose is like, well, you know what? There's one thing that our mother, who was like the queen witch, you know, taught me that she'd not tell you. And he's like, and what's that? And he pulls out a fucking gun and shoots him.
Oh my god. I do remember that now that you're refreshing my memory. And I'm like, I need to go watch this movie again because it has been longer than I care to mention numerically. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was good. Yeah. There are some. Oh, in Legend, like
where it's Zelda, but Tom Cruise is Link.
Yeah, Tom Cruise is Link, and it's like the, you know, Tim Curry is the devil, which is fantastic. And I realized, like, okay, you remember the part where he's approaching the like evil castle and he's going through the swamp and he runs into the troll lady?
Yeah,
I rewatched that recently. She's got like floppy tits hanging out. Like she is fully naked and they are like saggy little boobies.
Hey, look, we're not shaming women with saggy tits on this.
No, we're not. But I was like, I watched this as a child.
But going back to things that people get mad about when you point out, people are always like, oh, hey, there's nothing wrong with having saggy boobs, but they get mad when like I suggest wrapping them around my head like a turban and have her call me the Sultan. All of a sudden, I'm the asshole.
Well, and the thing is, I remember that some of my friends weren't allowed to watch a lot of the movies I was. And I noticed that a lot of those movies, including Legend, had nudity in them. And because my parents are close.
Huh? Well, I guess you said, yeah.
Yeah, they had, like, and it was brief, but, like, my parents are first generation American, so they're well, no, my father isn't, but, like, my mother is, they're still very close to Europe, so they could give a shit about nudity. Like, they never, they, like, it didn't matter. Like, I used to sit on the edge of the bathtub with my mom and have conversations with her while she was fully naked. It didn't matter. Like, it was just a body. And that's how we were taught. So they didn't care if I saw naked people. But I was like, but my friend's parents cared. And it's just the whole, like, you know, Puritan American culture. Even people who aren't Puritans don't realize that the Puritan culture just permeates.
Yeah. And it's kind of funny now because, like, you know, I grew up with a similar fucking, you know, mindset. Like, you can't look at that. Oh, fuck. Well, I better commit this entire movie to memory because I'm not going to ever watch it again. But then, like, now, like, you know, me and my wife will be watching something, and then, like, we'll watch a Van Damme movie and get mad that we don't see his ass in it. You know? It's like, hold on. I see his ass in every other fucking movie. Like, I think that I should see his ass in this movie.
Appreciate the fact that this is something that happens in Van Damme movies, and we need to check it off the list. It's important.
Yeah.
It's very important.
I am also still immature. Well, me and my wife are both immature on this, which I think is why it works.
Yeah.
Because, like, every time somebody gets naked, boobs or dinger.
But that's just fun. That's just good fun. I don't know. And I don't know. I always feel that people are too weird about nudity. I'm just like, it's just a fucking body. Like, that's it. Well, you know,
is it that heathen witchcraft?
Yeah, it's heathen witchcraft. Well, like, and as a pole dancer, like, I know about a lot of polers, I know strippers, and I know a lot of burlesque dancers, and I'm like, it's just a fucking body. And most of burlesque, for people who haven't seen it, is hilarious. It's women in full-on, like, comical lobster costumes going out to the B-52's Rock Lobster and stripping to it, and it's fucking awesome. Yeah, Rock Lobster. I've seen that routine. It was amazing. I loved it. And they, like, stripped down to little red pasty tassels and things like, but they started in a cartoonishly large lobster costume, and it's like, it's not about the new, it's a, I don't know, it's a whole different mindset.
What I will say, shattered some dreams when I found out that the stripper pole isn't fixed. I was like, oh, you bastards, you've lied to me.
Isn't fixed? What do you mean?
Like it spins, like you can spin it.
Oh, not all. Yeah, I can spin. I actually don't do spin because I get really bad vertigo. I have an inner ear thing, so I will vomit. But you can do what we call either static or spin. But most people do spin because of velocity of movement. Yeah. It's easier to do acrobatic moves because you already have the pole helping you stay up.
Yeah, doing your momentum and all that.
Yeah.
Well, that whatever the pole version of rug burn is.
Pole burn or whatever. Yeah. And honestly, like, cause there are I have a Chrome. Well, I've got my Chrome pole behind me. This is the pole studio / office / writing room / cosplay creation room. But
I'm totally not going to comment. Yeah. Do more pole stuff. Ah, take it off. I mean, like,
but I have a Chrome, they can be made out of brass, which is actually more abrasive. That they're both sticky and slippery, but, like, chrome is smoother, and brass you can actually get a metal burn from.
So I hear what you're saying, but my brain went somewhere else.
Well, get ready for
this. I'm going to go thump the fuck out of that page now, and all I'm going to comment is, show more feet, baby.
Yeah, do it. And, well, you know, and let me just put one more little thing in your brain. There are also poles that are coated with latex.
That doesn't sound like it would be easy to work with, but
you have to wear pants. You could rip your skin off with those. But if you're doing a lot of aerial work, especially if you're learning how to do aerial moves and you don't know how to, and you're not good at, like, sticking on the pole, like, if your armpit isn't strong enough yet to hold up your entire body weight on a chrome pole, then you, you know, when you have a latex pole, it's a lot easier to stay up. So it's a good practice thing.
So this is making me think, going back to like ancient civilizations and shit. So like Spartan women were described as being the most beautiful women in Greece, mm-hmm. mostly because they were allowed to exercise. So yeah. they couldn't like sit around and kind of get like pudgy and like, you know, turn like white because they stayed yeah. inside all day. They were outside getting their tan on, fucking doing push-ups and shit. So if I were to go to an ancient Greek strip club, like it'd be great because I'd be the only dude there.
Yeah.
Suck at Sparta and be all the chicks would be hot.
Well, and also interesting fact, the Etruscans, actually the ancient Etruscans, as you know, who actually built fucking Rome and gave the Romans, who were a bunch of sheep herders before the Etruscans told them how to do shit, a lot of things. They actually created the first gymnasiums, and women worked out with the men.
Yeah.
You know, because Etruscan women were just equal. They didn't have the different, like, women, you know, like certain roles would happen, but like gender equality was actually the norm in that ancient civilizations, which is one of the reasons the Romans and a lot of the Athenian Greeks hated them. And there were issues.
It had nothing to do with the military occupation of their country.
No. Well, the Etruscans did some shit too, and you know, but I don't like to talk about that. They were indigenous bunnies.
On my dad's side of the family, you know, my grandma had three sons. One of them's married to a Japanese chick. The other one's married to my dad's married to a German chick. And my uncle's married to somebody he went to high school with. And it's like, okay, listen, I love that aunt so much. But if he could have just married an Italian chick, I could have had a fucking axis of fucking family members.
Could have. Damn it. Could have had the axis.
But that made me think of, like, yeah, I don't want to talk about that. You know, going back to the Germans on that side. It's like, hey, so what were you guys doing back in? We were all on vacation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right.
Yep. On vacation. That's how that works. Yeah. But the Etruscan women were also considered to be gorgeous by other like Roman and Greek standards. They were like, oh, those ladies are super hot though. And it's like, really? Is it because they work out? Is it because they're allowed
to? I'm sure it had nothing to do with the fact that, like, A, they're in Italy, so they probably know how to cook.
I don't know. They're just
a little bit prejudiced here, but you know, a like dark fucking hair and the fucking like bronze, I've been outside fucking skin, and the listen, I know you work out, but like I can also tell you eat pasta, so that means, you know, you're
hotter.
That had nothing to do with it.
Nothing at all. No Yeah. Well, to be fair though, the Greek women have that same, you know, they got the beautiful bronze skin, dark hair, and not so much pasta, but they, you know, a lot of falafel.
yeah but they also like They did the whole octopus thing there, and fucking octopus is fucking goddamn delicious.
So. Oh, octopus is, yeah, both the whole Mediterranean world, as far as I know, has some octopus dish of some kind. Excuse me.
I love the argument where, like, is hummus Greek or is it like Lebanese? How about you shut up and fucking give it to me? I don't give a fuck who made it.
Hummus is fucking delicious. Well, they say that they're a Greek restaurant. I actually think they're more Turkish. They just don't call themselves Turkish because
people around here don't know what the fuck that means. Anatolia, which is just East Greece.
Mm-hmm.
Like, no, you lost the Trojan War. You're not Greek anymore. Shut up.
Yeah, they have the best fucking hummus. They're so and they will serve it. They serve you like the hummus, and you get it with this like perfectly yummy baked, like flatbread, sesame flatbread, and a red pepper like chutney on the side with olive oil.
Does it have that like little bit of film of olive oil on top?
Yeah, little film of olive oil with like the black cracked pepper and garlic and shit, and it's really fucking delicious. And you can just like have it all three, you know, just like the bread with the hummus and it's so, I fucking love that restaurant. Now I need to go eat there.
Yeah. No, and then going back to, like, you know, making people mad about how you describe stuff. Yeah, give me the shawarma. It's falafel.
Just give that to me.
Put it on a plate, man.
Yeah. Give me the thing.
The money.
Yeah. I want to eat that food. The end. Yeah. Like, there's a lot, like, I don't know. I love a diner with a lot of pictures because I'm just like.
That one, yeah.
That one. Well, I don't know which one it is here.
Yeah, what does kind of fucking like tickle my brain housing group on the Italian and Greek food thing. I know it's different there, but like when it comes over here where you get it, it's like, okay, there's a lot more seafood in this diet.
Yes.
Where is that? Where is that on the fucking menu, bro? Because like, Greece is a peninsula and a bunch of islands, and Italy's a fucking peninsula. You got ocean everywhere. Don't tell me you didn't have fucking goddamn fishermen.
Oh no.
Where's the fish?
Yeah. Well, real Italians, like I grew up like eating like a pescatarian, you know, yeah. A lot. It's and of course, you know, like we had meat and stuff too, but meat was not a staple in the diet.
Yeah.
So much because, you know, I was raised on a Mediterranean diet and that's actually what I've gone back to. And I've suddenly become healthier again. Like that's
Wait. So you're eating healthier food and you become healthier.
I know it's weird.
That's I don't know about that.
I know. It's weird that I feel better now. It's fucked up. Tell you all. But yeah, so I just like, yeah, but there's a ton of fish. There's always so much fucking fish. And it's like people don't even realize, like when I was in Greece, because I went to Greece last year,
uh-huh.
My sister-in-law. And we had a lot of fun. But I got this fucking, I don't even know what kind of sandwich to call it. It was like a pita. It was a gyro essentially. And yeah. But it had like fried fish, like fried falafel balls of just white fish in okay. it. But it wasn't like the white, but it was like, it looked like falafel, but it wasn't. It was fried white fish. I'm trying not to say fish balls because I know where your brain's going to go, but there, I've said it now.
I'm not sure where fish balls are supposed to take me.
I just thought you would take it to, you know, sexual organs.
Well, I mean, like, yeah, but like balls are one thing and fish is a poor hygiene fucking thing. They're not necessarily fucking related.
That's true.
That's true. Which I do love that joke. It's like, oh, I was at a fish market. Hello, ladies. Like, did none of the ladies have soap? Because you know what prevents your fucking vagina smelling like a fucking rotten fish? Taking a shower.
Yeah.
You know, but.
Same thing with the balls. That's it. Yep. You just gotta clean it. Just clean everything. You're gonna smell great. I would like
to introduce you to my friend. His name is Soap.
it's hygiene, everyone. Enjoy. But no, it was so fucking delicious. And it had like, of course, like shredded cabbage and like mm-hmm. not cabbage. No, it was like shredded lettuce and like lettuce, peppers, yeah. And I don't know. It was so fucking good though. And it had the good like tzatziki sauce. And I just like I don't know. We went back to that restaurant like 3 times because we loved everything we ate there. And we were like, we have to go back here. It was in Athens. Like if I went to Athens, Greece again right now, I could fucking find that restaurant because it's embedded in my brain. I'm like, I'm going back to that place.
Yeah.
Yeah. But there's a lot of fish. Like but most Italian restaurants, when people think of Italy, they think spaghetti and meatballs. So serve a lot of meat.
Yeah, no, that was one of the things though that I was happy about when I went to Japan, because like all the stereotypes are right. It's like, all right, so what are we getting here? No salmon, no mahi mahi. You're getting whale and shark.
Yep.
And whale shark if you go to the right place. It's like, wait, is there anything in here that's not on the endangered species list?
Yeah. Have some pufferfish, play a game. But then there's also conveyor belt sushi in Japan, which is fabulous and very fun. Even if you're not a big sushi fan, I still recommend going to one of those places just for the enjoyment of the atmosphere.
The experience alone.
Yeah. I mean, they've got shit on there that's not, they've got the little sides. And sometimes they have like, I was in a couple of them that would serve like the red bean buns around afterward. Oh my God. Did you, I'm sorry if you heard that my husband just sneezed upstairs. It sounded like a dog barking. Sorry, I don't know if you could hear that, but that was funny to me.
It was something. Yeah, I wasn't ever big on Japanese sweets. Yeah, like it was like, nah, dude, I want my sweets to be, you know, sweet.
It's a very different kind. See, I like it, but it is a very different flavor.
Yeah.
But I like, if it's sweet, I'm probably just going to eat it. I don't, I like most. I get the differences in flavor, but if it's dessert, I'm here. I'm here for it in most cases.
Yeah, no, like that's the difference between like, Black Forest cake and German chocolate cake. So like German chocolate cake is called German chocolate cake because the guy that came up with its last name was German.
Mm-hmm.
It was Canadian, I think. So it has nothing to do with Germany. So it's coconuts. And it's like, who the fuck is putting coconut in a goddamn cake? But you go to Black Forest cake and Black Forest you think about the Black Forest, you think of like witches and goblins and the darkness, and it's gummy bears and cuckoo clocks and this awesome cake that's just fucking chocolate and cherries.
I fucking love. Yeah, and it's usually dark chocolate, which I am a huge fan of, and yeah. It's with like just the right amount of cream and the cherry. Yeah, it's delicious. God, I need to bake now. I just need to go bake because, yeah, that's what's making. Because I don't feel like spending money, which means I have to make it myself.
Yeah, dude, no, and that's the fucking bitch of it, man. Because like, if you go somewhere and like get like, I don't know, chicken at a restaurant, that's $15. I bought 2 pounds of chicken thighs for fucking $3 today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just made like an outstanding goddamn chili last week. It is gone now. I had like sweet habanero peppers in it and a lot of other veg and, you know, like black beans, all this delicious shit.
Yeah.
And I was putting that, and I had queso fresco and all of that. I was putting that shit over mashed potatoes and all sorts of, honestly, my favorite meal of the week. And I homemade everything because I am that bitch. But like mashed potatoes from scratch, everything. And I don't do my mashed potatoes because my husband's lactose intolerant. I actually do them with garlic broth instead of milk.
Okay. See, you said he was lactose intolerant, so I thought you were going to say some like vegan bullshit, but like this, I'm interested. Go on. Tell me about
garlic broth.
Tell me about this.
And a little mayonnaise.
Okay.
And if you know, since he has lactose intolerant, like sometimes, like he's okay with butter most of the time. I'll usually put a little bit of butter in there. But like, it is so delicious and creamy. And it's garlic broth. So it's garlic mashed potatoes. And so I like steam the mashed potatoes in garlic broth. I don't boil them. I steam them in garlic broth when they're all chopped up. And then, you know, you just like throw the, like a big spoonful of mayonnaise in there, salt, pepper. I throw like paprika because I love fucking paprika. And I put a little bit more garlic powder in there because that's important to me. And cracked black pepper is my favorite thing in the world. And you just mash that shit together, and it's delicious and dairy free.
works. But hey, on that, we're at an hour and fucking 40 minutes. So I am going to end this. Yeah.
It is time. It is time to go. I apologize.
No. We had a great time. Thank you everyone for listening, and go check out Hollis's books. And if you want to hear more of her voice, go check out my audiobooks. They're there. They're on both accounts. And we can find you where?
On Instagram at Hollis Jo McCollum. And basically, if you just type in Hollis Jo McCollum as it's written on the screen there, you will find me. I have a website, hollisjomccollumauthor.com, and that is also my YouTube.
Yes.
Yeah. And my handle is always Hollis Jo McCollum.
and there's a link in the description.
Yes. So. Please. Thank you.
All right, everybody, y'all have a good night.
Bye.